Yes. Yes, Christopher? Yeah, you could go ahead and ask your question.
Yes, Pastor, I wanted to actually get some clarification on those two Bible references on the notes. So 1 Timothy 1, 19, 20, and the other one, 1 Timothy 4, 14, 15. And just specifically around some of those words where in the first one, Paul mentions about, whom I delivered to Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. And in the second Bible reference, may the Lord repay him according to his works. So I think they're both, at least apparently it appears to be both with quite strong responses. And is it something that is right for people to do? There are people who have also talked sometimes like this, and they talk about God, asking God to repay a person for certain deeds. I think the first one is actually, I think, quite, I mean, much stronger. It talks about delivering to Satan. So just wanted to get your view on this.
Yeah, sure, Christopher. Yeah, I understand. It's sounds very serious, where Paul has completely given up on the person. So there's another reference. This is 2 Thessalonians 3, verses 6 through 15, where again, Paul is addressing a disorderly person. And for that person, again, I just read 11. A disorderly person. So he says, "For we hear that there are some who walk among you in a disorderly manner, not working at all, but are busybodies. Now those who are such, we command and exhort through our Lord Jesus Christ that they work in quietness and eat their own bread. But as for you, brethren, do not grow weary in doing good. And if anyone does not obey our word in this epistle, note that person and do not keep company with him, that he may be ashamed. Yet do not count him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother." So, I see here a redemptive approach. Okay, so he's saying somebody who's disorderly, you deal with it. Okay, you don't keep in touch with that person, don't even keep company with him, so that he may be ashamed. But the reason why Paul is asking somebody to do that is so that the person himself or herself will have remorse and hopefully come back to the right path. And he adds there, right? First, 2 Thessalonians 3:15. "Yet do not count him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother." So the heart is right. Now, even when Paul is talking about Hymenaeus and Alexander, I'm sure he has that same heart. And as scripture tells us, we have to go through that process. In Matthew 18, there is a progression, the way in which we must address somebody who has wronged us. I'll give you the reference for that. So this would be Matthew 18, verses 15 to 22, where we are told, go speak to the person. If they don't listen in private, if they don't listen, then take one more person with you. If they don't listen, then it's an issue which must be brought to the congregation. So I believe that Paul has gone through the process and he has found out that these people are unrepentant. And what we were saying earlier, in some of our discussions, we talked about people who have gone away from God and they are like unwilling to come back. So let me also give that reference to us. Just a moment. 1 John 5 and verse 16, where Apostle John, he writes, he says, if you see any brother or sister commit a sin that does not lead to death, you should pray and God will give them life. I refer to those whose sin does not lead to death. There is a sin that leads to death. I'm not saying that you should pray about that. So Hebrews 6 is another passage where we have a similar thing going on, where the writer says that there are people who have crossed that thin line, okay? And they've fallen in such a manner that they are unwilling to come back. So as far as my understanding of these two verses goes, Christopher, what I feel is, I'm sure Paul must have gone through the process of correcting these individuals, but both of them seem to be those who have, gone far away from God, and which is why he's having to be very, very strict with them. But even in his statement, where he says, give this person over to Satan, there is a component of redemption. Look what he's saying. He's saying, Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I delivered to Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. Okay, and basically, as we saw earlier when he wrote to the Thessalonians, if we cut contact with this sinning individual, hopefully they will come to a place of repentance and remorse. So the intention is still restoration, though the action is very hard of kind of delivering that person. Okay, we no longer are there to help you. You deal with your own situation. And in 1 Timothy 4, this statement, I understand it. It is a little, it doesn't sound like a very loving or a gentle act, where he says, may the Lord repay him according to his works. Okay. But we know that, how do I put this? Scriptures call us to live peaceably with people as far as possible. So we are called to do that. But maybe in this situation, I'm thinking, after having attempted, reconciliation and all of that, if somebody is continuing to wrong Paul, maybe that's just a statement where he's saying, I want justice. But then, the way it's written, it says, may the Lord repay him according to his works. It's like declaring judgment. Christopher, in the early church, there are instances under the leading of the Holy Spirit, judgment being pronounced on people. Okay, so it's not unusual in that sense. Like if you read about Ananias and Sapphira in Acts 5, they lied to the Holy Spirit, and the moment Peter brings it up, they are judged. And these are believers. These are sinning believers. Okay. And yes, there are, of course, unbelievers also. There's a sorcerer, I think, in Acts 10. Acts 10, yeah. It's 10, 11. Okay. Anyway. So there's a sorcerer whom Peter rebukes, and he's unable to see. Okay, I'm a little confused about the exact people in the chapter there, but that person goes blind, the sorcerer goes blind. Okay, so there's judgment. So what I'm saying is, as an apostle, Paul must have gone through the process of forgiveness and reconciliation, but it is likely that these individuals had crossed the limit. So which is why there is a statement of judgment spoken over them.
Thank you. I understand that. I mean, but just looking at these two verses again, I think the The first one, I think, is seems to be more harsher because he's talking about delivering to Satan. The other one is kind of like sort of stepping aside and saying, okay, you know, let God, let the Lord, you know, deal with the situation, you know, deal with them according to his works. So anyway, just one real quick clarification on another Bible reference, of course, completely, you know, not a, I mean, away from, you know, the current one that we have, but just on the on Psalm 91, where we talked about, you know, in verse 8, where they say, only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Does that actually mean that that we see how the wicked are in a sense, you know, in quotes, rewarded? The wicked are, you know, given, you know, they're just sort of, you know, the way they God will deal with the wicked. Is that what it means?
So are you saying that the wicked will reap what they have sown?
Correct.
Yes, Christopher, that's what we see in scripture.
Right. So I mean, I think in a way similar to the these two Bible references also, where you know, God will you know, deal with the wicked in a way that you know, deserving of what, you know, what they have done. So just wanted to confirm that.
Yes. Yeah, that's what scriptures tell us. And the same Paul, you know, he says the vengeance is the Lord's. You know, so God is a God of oneness, that sin has consequences. When we sow to righteousness, we reap of righteousness. When we sow to wickedness, we reap the consequences of wickedness. So it's just a cause and effect thing that happens. So those who are sinning, they will face the consequences of it. But at the same time, scriptures do tell us, like Psalm 89 and verse 14, it says, righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Love and faithfulness go before you. So we serve a God who is just. Okay, and that's where all these things, like what Paul was saying, that kind of, you know, you will receive for the evil that you have done, because God is fair, God is just, God is fair. So, yeah, God's justice also is something that we must fear. Yeah. So, okay, sure. Thank you, Christopher. Thank you for that. Was there one more hand which was up, or if not, we can just move on to the next section here. Okay, all right. So I think we have, you know, addressed this matter as much as possible, but we will again come back to correction in our subject on the local church, because there is a chapter there, and if you are keen and interested, you can look it up right away. This is in the APC publication called House of God, and the topic that talks about church discipline, so how to deal with more specific issues, and also how to address the matter if the issue is with the leadership, you know, how to actually go about dealing with it. So I think I will let you look at that. And Harrison, just adding to what we said about leadership, correcting leaders. So the first thing is to not take an accusation, and if there are witnesses, then to address it in an honorable way with the leader. Now, if the leader is unwilling to repent or make restitution, in that case, you know, Paul does write to the Thessalonians. He says, in fact, verse 20 of that passage, he says that we can bring it out in the open. Okay, so you can address the matter in public if the person is unwilling, if the leader is unwilling to repent. So that's also there. And I think it'll be good if you can just go through that chapter on church discipline, and that'll help us. Okay, so thank you everyone. That was good, interactive. We are trying to understand, you know, practical aspects of working with people. Now, moving on to the next chapter here in Kingdom Builders, this is about partnership, and it's about being co-workers in the Kingdom of God. So obviously, we understand that God's kingdom is a huge kingdom. It's a large kingdom, and everyone who is a part of it, you know, God calls us to serve in some way or the other. And for us to do our part, we must also learn to serve together with other people in the kingdom of God. So, in Paul's experience, 1 Corinthians 3 verses 6 through 8. You know, we've seen the same passage earlier where Paul says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then, neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now, he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. And verse 9 of the same passage, Paul says, for we are God's fellow workers. So the concept of working together in the kingdom of God, that Paul understood. And that's what he's saying. For a while, when he was not there in the Corinthian church, there was this eloquent, well-read, learned individual called Apollos. And he let Apollos take charge and minister to the people at that time. So that's what he's saying. Look, I planted. You know, the ministry began with me. But Apollos came in when I couldn't be with you all. And he served. He ministered the word to all of you. But you see, God is blessing the labor of every individual. He says, we are fellow workers. We're all working together to build God's kingdom. So partnership plays a very, very important role, and we have to recognize that we have to work together with people. And a lot more can be accomplished when we receive this truth that we have to work alongside people. And in this way, we will be able to advance the kingdom of God. Talking about the kingdom of God, we dealt with the God-given vision. We dealt with the dream. Now, going back to Nehemiah's example, imagine, you know, God put it in his heart to go and build the walls. But if it was only Nehemiah alone who had to go and do this work, I don't think he would have completed it in 52 days. But he had people with him who were partnering in that vision, who were partnering in the dream. So we have to recognize that the dreams and the visions that God gives us, they are interconnected. They are interlinked. So one person serving their God-given dream, you know, somehow when they're doing their part, I'm doing my part. You know, we are serving the kingdom of God, and we are causing the growth of the kingdom of God, and we are connected in some way. Okay, so that is how the kingdom of God works. So we are not independent of each other. We are interconnected and interlinked. But in the kingdom of God, whenever there are incidents where people don't get along, okay, so you could look at it like an army, God's army. What if the soldiers don't get along? Every soldier has the cause of the nation in their hearts, and they're on the front line serving the country, protecting the country. But what if they start fighting among each other? You know, a house which is divided cannot stand, and that should never happen in an army. So in the same way, believers must learn to recognize other believers, that every single person is called, they have their ministry, we are connected, our dreams are connected, our visions are connected, so we have to learn to work together. And it is even more unfortunate when we have people who are experienced in the kingdom of God. You know, we would probably use the term, call them generals or something, you know, people who have served God for many years. For example, Paul and Barnabas, you know, they had that sharp argument about John Mark. And what happened? They parted ways, right? It was really, don't know what the chapters would cover if they both were together. But they were not together. Later on, Barnabas, both these stalwarts in the kingdom of God, they had an argument and they parted ways. So when this kind of disagreement and quarreling and division happens at with leaders, it's even more unfortunate. And you know, that's what enemy wants, right? He wants people to be against one another so that we will not advance the kingdom. In fact, he doesn't have a lot of work to do if we are fighting among ourselves and leaders are fighting against each other in the body of Christ. So that is something that we must be very, very wary about. And the enemy is out to catch lone rangers. He's very happy when people are, you know, they don't want to associate with others. They're by themselves. He can play a game of deception. But God has called us to work together. God has called us to serve one another and see our dreams and our visions come true together. So we have to work for unity. As I already told us, a kingdom which is divided cannot stand. So we cannot make God's kingdom progress if we don't learn to work together or partner with one another. So we must maintain the unity in the spirit. Ephesians 4:3, I'm on page 79. Ephesians 4:3 tells us that endeavoring to keep the unity of the spirit in the bond of peace. So that is the call which all of us have. We have to promote unity. We must promote unity and maintain love, maintain peace with one another. And that is the true attitude of a kingdom builder, and it will result in the strengthening of the kingdom of God. And you know, any form of division for that matter, we must be very, very careful about it. And that's what Satan really wants. I'm just reminded of the revival of Azusa Street, 1905. We read about the revival, and you know, it was one that made a mark on the you know, the teaching on the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the baptism in the Holy Spirit, because it was all becoming very real when God was ministering to the people during that revival. And it was going really well, it was going beautifully well, but apparently, you know, there were some internal conflicts that started towards the end of the revival. The people who were leading it, there was one particular lady who was part of, you know, that key team, who got upset with William J. Seymour, who is the, you know, the main man that God worked through in that revival. She got upset with him or something like that. And she had a record of the people, like she would maintain the books. So she kind of took the book and she left, something like that. So, and that caused a lot of difficulty, like, you know, logistically, and then there was division and all. And, you know, these things hindered the revival. So was it God who wanted to bring his mighty work to an end? No, not really. It was the internal conflicts which people had, you know, that affected the revival in some way. And, you know, this is true of many other kingdom stories as well. God wants to continue to do his work, but when people don't get along, when we don't learn to honor one another, our positions and our anointing, our calling, our vision, that's when we become, you know, difficult to deal with, and God's work cannot progress. So we have to be very careful. Endeavoring, remember we talked about it, endeavoring is in a fast way, in a quick way. We have to resolve, maintain peace in the quickest possible way, because it's very important. Satan knows if he can find a crack in the unity of the believers, he can come in quickly and he can destroy. And just while talking about, you know, understanding others and recognizing the calling that God has over their lives in the kingdom and partnering with people, you know, Jesus said, his disciples came back and they were saying, we saw somebody else ministering in your name, you know, how can they use your name, Jesus? They are not part of our group. But you know, Jesus says, no, don't forbid that person, for he who is not against you is on our side. So there are so many ministers of God. There are so many people serving, believers serving God. And whenever we come across any person who's in the kingdom, who's in the body, who is serving in the name of Jesus, you know, we must be rejoicing about them. And we must be encouraging of them rather than getting insecure and jealous that there are others who are also working in the kingdom of God and advancing the kingdom of God. So let's try to maintain that unity. Let's try to have an attitude of partnership. So we are also encouraged that we must be kingdom-minded. Kingdom-minded meaning having that mindset that what is it that matters? You know, it's the advancement of the kingdom. So whatever it takes, it's not about you, it's not about me, but we will work together. And Deuteronomy 22:10, it says, you shall not plow with an ox and a donkey together. So basically it says, when mindsets don't match, right, when we don't try to maintain that kingdom mindset, there will be divisions. Amos 3:3, it says, can two walk together unless they are agreed? But when we have a kingdom mindset and we say, okay, we will maintain the peace in the body of Christ, no matter what. Yes, we may have our differences of opinion. And again, we have talked about this earlier. As long as the core issues are things that we agree on, no, we are brothers and sisters. We can work together. So core issues would be, we believe the same thing about who Jesus is. We believe the same thing about his finished work on the cross. We believe the same thing about his death, his resurrection, his return, about the fact that we have the Great Commission that we need to fulfill, and that's what we are living for, right? So these are the core issues. We agree on these matters. Now, peripherally, there can be certain things that we disagree on, you know, the way church should be done, or I don't know, something with regard to a revelation in scripture which one group is not able to accept yet. All those things, that's fine. You know, over a period of time, maybe that group will accept the revelation which is given in God's word. But we must not make the minor issues the major issues. You know, when we are trying to major on the minors, we get into trouble. But we maintain, we focus that unity, we maintain that kingdom mindset and say, okay, if you are serving God, we are together. Now let's maintain that oneness of mind. Let's advance the kingdom of God together. Let's serve as brothers and sisters. So maintain the unity of the spirit and put God's kingdom ahead of our personal ministry. Now this, you know, all this is applicable, like we are learning this as a spiritual truth, but when we're interacting with people, we will have an opportunity to apply these things. You know, there will be times when there is a question, okay, should I give priority to my ministry, you know, my name, my, you know, whatever, my sermons, my accomplishments, or when we're working together with people, maybe let's simply, one simple example, there is a program, okay, which a few pastors are organizing together, and they have put down an agenda and they've said, okay, you do the introduction and the welcome, this pastor will do the you know, the sermon, this pastor will do the ministry time, and you know, some other pastor will come and do the benediction and close off the program. But Maybe, you know, something happens in, during, as you're planning that program, you realize, oh, somebody has come to attend the program who is like one of the generals in the kingdom of God, and all of you discuss and you decide, okay, we want to honor this individual. How about we give that person time to speak? Okay? So when you're trying to accommodate a new item in your program, it is likely that one of you has to give up doing what you're doing. So at that point, is any one of the minister ready to say, okay, see, if I don't speak today in the program, people will not know that I'm one of the organizers. See, if I don't speak in the program today, people will not know, you know, what a wonderful sermon I have. See, practically, when it comes to practical things, you know, these things really bother us in our hearts. But it is in moments like that when we are saying, you know what, it doesn't matter. This is about the kingdom of God. This is about the household of God. This is about the family of God. Okay, brother, I will not do it. You tell, you give my chance to that person or something like that. You know, that's a very generous and a magnanimous way of dealing with the situation. But in practicality, right, these things are challenging on the ground. When we observe people dealing with these matters, not everyone is of the mindset where they say, okay, seek first the kingdom of God. It doesn't matter. My ministry, the name of my ministry, I did this. If people don't know it, it doesn't matter. You know, we have to grow into that maturity. And that is where, it shows that we've understood what the kingdom means and what partnership in the kingdom means, what the advancement of the kingdom really means. Otherwise, what happens? We are trying to advance our own personal agenda. Maybe we have a vision for our ministry, if a certain opportunity, we miss that opportunity, then we are missing that kind of a momentum, you know, for our ministry. So it can be a loss for us. But are we of the kingdom mindset to say, my ministry is not as important as the kingdom? So we honor the work of the kingdom, and we put the kingdom ahead of everything else. So, these are some basic things for us to have very clear in our hearts. Now let's continue to learn a little bit more about kingdom work. Because the kingdom of God involves people and, you know, various ministers, we have to learn to connect and work together. We are designed for partnership. The example where we said that the church is the body of Christ, there we said that there are many members, right? Even in the physical body, there are many members. But the beautiful thing is all the members learn to work together because it is one body. And in the same way, when it comes to the family of God, 1 Corinthians 12:18, we learn, but now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. So God has positioned people according to his will, and we have to learn to work together. So everyone does their part. Everyone supplies whatever they have to offer, as Ephesians 4:16 says, and we partner together. So what is partnering? Partnering simply means that we are complementing each other. The grace that God has given upon one person's life, it's beautiful. We receive from it, and then, you know, there's the grace on another person's life. We need that also, so we're receiving from it. And partnering, while partnering, we have to be careful that we don't start competing with each other. Because if we start competing with each other, then, you know, we're no longer fitting that description of the human body where every member has a part to play and every member is significant. So each of us is designed to partner in the kingdom of God. Okay. And as long as, you know, we recognize this, and the motivation for us growing in the anointing, the motivation for us maturing in the in our walk with the Lord, the motivation for us to hone our skills, if it is that the kingdom of God must advance, you know, it's a beautiful thing, because then What will happen? Everybody is growing together, and God is able to release new moves. You know, even as we go ahead into the seasons that God has placed before us, we will see new moves of God, because every single person is doing their part. Every single person is growing and also learning to work with others. Okay. So we have been designed for partnership, and each person has to do their part. Now, just going back to the analogy of planting and Apollos watering, we recognize there that each person has a role to play in the ministry. Okay. Now, it could be at the same time. Now, there can be many people who are serving in the ministry in different capacities at the same time, or once the way, Paul was serving the Corinthian church, and then he moved on, and Apollos was the one who kind of came and took over the teaching role there. They're in different seasons, right? The same task, somebody else takes over. Whichever manner, this happens, we are laboring together. God sends people, sends people to work with us, or the Lord can send people to enter into our labor. Now, sometimes it's difficult to receive that. Okay, we get very attached to our ministry and we are not ready to let go. But it is possible that God sends somebody to walk into our labor. But we need the willingness to let go and say, okay, my season is over. I have to give this over to another person whom God has called for this time and this season. So this is the manner in which we partner together, and we go by God's timing. We go by God's way of leading us. And particularly when it comes to us handing over to someone, the ministry that we've been working in, we might wonder, Lord, I served so hard and I haven't seen a harvest, and here you are telling me to hand this over to somebody else. What is going on? Maybe the way Paul said, I planted. Maybe it's the season of planting for which God has graced us. And that is the task which he has called us to do. And obviously, in the season of planting, you don't see a mighty harvest, right? Because the process has to take place. So we have to be in sync with the leading of the Holy Spirit and be okay, right, with our role. No matter how it appears to people outside and what people outside can comment about our ministry, they might look at our ministry and say, look at that person, church planting, they are struggling for 3 years. What are they doing? They are just trying to find a place. They are just trying to keep their 20 people together. And no, ministry is not very effective. We can have comments like this. People can say all kinds of things. But where are we with God? Are we in a place where we're saying, okay, God, you called me to do this. I'm clear about that. You've given me the grace. I will keep doing what you've asked me to do. Now, we don't know, right? Like, if God may bring somebody else into our labor and they have to start off serving the next season where that actual visible growth as such would be seen. But we did our part where we sowed spiritually, and that spiritual growth was taking place while we were making our investments. So these are all the ways in which God wants us to serve together, partner together, receive one another. I think I will just stop here for today, and then we will continue in our next class. So any thoughts at this point? Anything you want to add to what I've been saying? Feel free to do that. If not, we will pray, wrap up, and then come back. Next session. All right, so we will keep getting deeper into this topic of partnering and working together, and look at some of the practical aspects. I think then it'll be a lot easier for us to ask questions too. All right, so let's pray then. We'll pray and we will close for today. We'd like to request someone to pray, please. Anyone, if you're able to unmute and pray.
Can I pray again?
Yes, yes, Harrison.
Our Father and our God, we want to thank you. We want to give you all the praise and we want to give you all the glory because you are the God, you know, that rules over every nation and you are the God of all universe. We thank you for our churches. We thank you for our ministers. We thank you for our pastors. We thank you for our reverends and we thank you for our bishops. We thank you for everyone, oh God, that you have made disciples. We thank you because we will not just be hearers of your word, but Father, we shall be doers of your word. We pray that you will equip us, oh God, with the right knowledge to run this race to the end. We pray that you will give us the grace to persevere. We pray, Lord, that you will help us, oh God, to make decisions, oh God, that glorify your name. We pray, Lord, that you will give us the ability to be at peace with all men, that we may not be found, oh God, unworthy before you. We pray, Father, that you will help us, oh God, to serve in truth and in spirit, that even as we carry our cross, oh God, to follow you, we will carry our cross and follow you to the end. Holy Spirit, we need you. Guide our thoughts, guide our minds, guide our movements, guide our decisions. Help us to see Jesus the way he is. Help us, Father, our God, to know you better. Because this is all we want to know and this is all we want to live for. Help us, O God, to live according to your will and not the will of men. Help us, O God, that we may not depart from your presence. Help us, O God, that our selfish aim, O God, will not come before your will for our lives. Help us that we may be able to fulfill the purpose by which, O God, you have brought us into this world. I thank you, Father, because I know that you're taking us, O God, to the place of promise. It is not an accident, O God, that we find ourselves, O God, listening to the word of God here. But because you have laid it in our heart, O God, and because you want to see your kingdom, O God, expand, and you want to bring, O God, change, O God, into every nation and tribes, we pray, Father, that you will help us, O God, to fulfill that which you've assigned us to fulfill. We thank you for APC Bible College. We thank you for what they are doing in the Christendom. We thank you for every ministers and pastors in this college. And we pray, Father, that you continually equip them for the great assignment ahead. And we pray, Lord, Father, that we, the students of God, we make them proud and become a disciple for all nations. We bless your name because we know that greatness awaits everyone. Blessed be your holy name, Father, for in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you, Harrison. Yeah, bless. Yeah, so thank you, class. God bless you. And we shall meet again in our next class on the local church.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Abhishek. Thank you, everyone. Rose, Makash, Angi, Pratik, everyone. Bye.